All right, well, man, I am excited to be with each one of you. If we haven't met yet, my name is Bryce. I'm the Student Ministries pastor here at Saddleback. But more importantly, I am matching with about 30 of you. So those are the people I'm really saying hi to. Great outfit choice tonight. But show of hands, who's wearing the Move shirt? The black one specifically. See, you guys picked the right shirt. The blue one just wasn't for me. But anyways, man, I'm so excited to be here. We are launching a new series at all of our campuses for all student ministries called Blessed. All right, I asked about 10 of you how you would define being blessed. I asked 10 high schoolers in HSM, how would you describe being blessed? Here's the answers. Here's what you had to say. The first one was having shelter, food, and a fam who loves you, having success, having leaders and mentors who push me closer to God, recognizing all the things that God has given me. Being blessed means to know that God cares about me and wants what's best for me, recognizing God's gift in my life, knowing that God loves me and gives me grace and mercy, being made holy and clean because of God, feeling honored and grateful to be included in something that you don't think you deserve. All fantastic answers. Do me a favor, if you don't have an outline or a pen, raise your hand and a leader will get that to you. You'll need that, but here's what I want you to do. I want you on the top of your outline to write your own definition of what it means to be blessed. You can use something up here. You can use something that God is putting on your heart right now. But what do you think it means to be blessed? Now, spoiler alert, I'm going to tell you in a couple seconds, but before we get to that, I am excited that you're here, because once again, we are starting a new series called Blessed. And as Dawson explained, we are going to look specifically at this Matthew 5 passage called the Beatitudes. If you don't know what the word beatitude means, maybe write that down somewhere else, because that's going to be a term we're using quite a bit in this series. But beatitude means supreme blessedness. And I love that that word supreme is there. It's essentially just another way to say extremely blessed. And blessed, by definition, means to be made holy or consecrated. Consecrated is a famous, not famous, but a well-known term in the Bible that just means to be set apart, to be made holy. So before we get into this, that is what the word blessed means. And now all these answers that each one of you described is accurate, because all of those answers mean that you recognize that you have supreme blessedness in your life. You see, when Jesus began his announcement of this good news, if you've never been to church before, or if you're new to this thing called faith, we use this term good news, which is essentially means the kingdom of God. It means the gospel. It means what it means to come into a relationship with Jesus. But when Jesus begins this announcement of this good news, it's finally him saying that I am bringing God's kingdom down to this earth. And that's where we find ourselves as we pick up this passage in Matthew 5, which is called the Sermon on the Mount. As Dawson said, the Sermon on the Mount is well known because it's one of Jesus's most well-known sermons. It would be like Jesus stepping in front of a crowd like you and giving some teachings, but it was really important because it was early on in his ministry. And it was kind of him just setting this tone of what he is going to bring to earth. You see, Jesus is giving this primary address. He's giving this big sermon on the nature and the character of the kingdom of God. Before we jump in, I want you to think about two questions. I want you to think about, as we're reading Matthew 4 and 5, what kind of world is Jesus talking about? And is it one that you want to be a part of? Let's pick up in Matthew 4. It's on your outline. It's going to be up on the screen. But this is before Jesus starts, and it's setting the tone and the setting of this sermon. It says this: Jesus traveled throughout the region of Galilee, teaching in the synagogues and announcing the good news about the kingdom, as he healed every kind of disease and illness. News about him spread as far as Syria, and people soon began bringing to him all who were sick. And whatever their sickness or disease, or if they were demon-possessed or epileptic or paralyzed, he healed them all. Large crowds followed him wherever he went. People from Galilee, the 10 towns, Jerusalem, from all over Judea, and from east of the Jordan River. Now, I know we just said a bunch of locations, and some of those locations, you're probably like, I have no idea where they are. Me too. I don't know. But what I do know is that what essentially we're being told is that people from all over are coming to hear Jesus. They've recognized that there's something different about this guy. There's something different that he is going to say and bring to us, and they want to kind of be in the room or the setting where it happened. But I don't know if you noticed, the Bible describes the type of people that are coming to hear this sermon. You see, it says that Jesus reaches out first to the sick, to the lame, to the paralyzed, to the epileptic. Jesus actually doesn't go to the rich, powerful, and popular. Jesus goes to those who are somewhat cast out at the time. And back in the time of Jesus, these people were extremely cast out. You couldn't even touch them or talk to them without having some sort of negative connotation attached to them. So what's important is that we know when Jesus is beginning this sermon that he's actually going to the outcasts. He's going to the least of these. And that is who he is bringing this kingdom to. And it's a part of social and religious, essentially nobodies, that Jesus begins to reveal this great kingdom that he is bringing about. Over the next few weeks, we're going to take a deep dive into these 9 statements that are called the Beatitudes. And we're going to jump into them today and kind of just give a big overview. And then over the next couple of weeks, we're really going to break them down further and further and apply the specific words. But once again, tonight, we're just going to reveal what the Beatitudes are. And the first thing is, you can write this down on your outline, the Beatitudes reveal a blessed life. The Beatitudes reveal a blessed life. You see, a beatitude, as we said, is supreme blessedness, but a beatitude specifically in this passage is a description and an invitation to a way of living this good life. Jesus is essentially saying, this is gonna be my kingdom, and here's 9 ways that you can be a part of what I'm doing right now. You see, all kinds of teachers at the time gave beatitudes. It wasn't a holy term. It was just another word for teaching. But Jesus, his beatitudes were far different than anything that anybody had ever heard of at the time. You see, Jesus is going to use this word blessed quite a bit, and we're going to really look at this term blessed over the next couple weeks. And what we need to understand before we jump into this beatitude section is Jesus is essentially just describing that the life that he wants for us to live. That's essentially what it is. As Jesus is saying, hey, if you're gonna follow me, man, I hope that you take part in these characteristics. I hope that you help me bring heaven to earth. I hope that these are the things that you will be known by because you have me in your heart. Okay, let's jump in. I want you to actually look at your outline when we're reading. I don't want you looking at the screen. And here's what I want you to do. I want you to circle the word blessed every time I say it. So here we find ourselves in Matthew 5. This is the top of the Sermon on the Mount. And this is where we find the Beatitudes. It says this in verse 5. Now when Jesus saw the crowds, he went up on a mountainside and sat down. His disciples came to him and he began to teach them. He said this, blessed, circle, are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, which is another word for humble. They will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they are called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven, for in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. All right, 9 times. There's 9 different beatitudes that Jesus says. And what is so interesting about this passage, and imagine Jesus standing in front of this crowd, is that Jesus is essentially throwing out some interesting things that we probably wouldn't have chosen to be blessed by. You see, Jesus says, those are blessed who are poor in spirit. Those are blessed who mourn. Those are blessed who are persecuted. They don't naturally fit the term blessed, right? But that's exactly the point. You see, Jesus makes these nine statements, and an interesting thing about the Beatitudes are scholars believe that they are in a specific order on reason, because of a certain reason. They believe that Jesus is essentially building upon every Beatitude. So you can't achieve the next one without recognizing the first one. And the reason why the first one is so important is that blessed are those who are poor in spirit is because first, in order to get all the other things, we have to recognize that we are spiritually empty without Jesus. We are just spiritually empty without Jesus. And there's a specific reason before we even get to all the other ones that Jesus says, hey, in order for you to be a part of this God's kingdom, this heaven on earth, you have to recognize that you can literally do nothing without me. Maybe that's what you need to hear tonight, is you literally can't do anything without Jesus. I don't know about you, but I've read this passage quite a few times in my walk with Jesus. Maybe you've read it before, maybe this is your first time reading it. Man, it's a great passage for you to spend some time in if you're looking for a passage to have a quiet time in. But every time I read it, I am somewhat overwhelmed and shocked by what Jesus is actually saying. You know, there's something to recognize like, oh man, blessed are those who mourn, blessed are those who are persecuted, blessed are those who search for righteousness, who'd fight for it. Those are somewhat hard things to do. But I also love that Jesus reveals that on the other side of it, we can do anything because we're poor in spirit and we recognize our dependence. But as practically today, as followers of Christ in our day-to-day, what does it mean for us to live out these Beatitudes? And the thing I want you to know before we get any further is the Beatitudes are not a checklist, not a to-do list. Write that down on your outline. The Beatitudes are not a to-do list. You see, remember what Jesus is doing in this moment. He's painting this grand picture for us. He's getting us to think about what God's kingdom is compared to what the world is. You see, Jesus is not asking us to go be poor to get blessed. He's not asking us to seek out persecution. He's not at all. But what is he doing? Because he is doing something strategic, and Jesus is revealing to us this upside-down kingdom. He's revealing to us that with the Beatitudes, everything is flipped when we follow Jesus. The world's Beatitudes is one way. Jesus's Beatitudes are the other way. It would be way easier if the Beatitudes said, happy are the rich, or blessed are the careless, right? Those are what the world says. And once again, Jesus, before he's doing anything else, he is flipping the script, recognizing that we are bringing something new to this earth. If you follow Jesus, you are a part of bringing something new to this earth. The life of a humble, of a hungry, of a meek, of a merciful, of a peacemaker, man, that's not an easy life. In high school, you probably recognize that. That's not an easy life. But the great thing we can remember is that Jesus has lived this life. He recognizes that it's a hard life, and the end doesn't end when we die. The reward is still coming. So what I want you to know is that the Beatitudes are not a to-do list. They're actually the opposite. The Beatitudes are an invitation. You can write that down on your outline. The Beatitudes are an invitation. There's a big difference between a to-do list and an invitation. You see, a to-do list is something that you write down. Once it's done, you check, you move on to the next thing. You don't think about it. I don't know about you guys, but Mondays are my Sabbath. Most of you are in school on Mondays. So Saturday, before I come to church, it tends to be my like catch-up to-do list day. So my to-do list this morning was wake up with my son. He's 14 months, and he wakes up way too early. But we flip every other day, me and my wife, because we both hate the mornings. But today was my day. After that, my to-do list was give him milk, give him food, change his diaper, somehow wake up. After that, my to-do list was do our laundry, which is the worst chore in the world. After that, we went on a walk with my wife. After that, I vacuumed. My wife cleans the bathrooms because she's gross, and the bathrooms are gross. It's just gross. Girls, there's hair everywhere. I hate it. And then the last thing on my to-do list was watch the season finale of The Mole on Netflix. I won't give any spoilers away. Wow, that got quite the reaction. I guessed it right, so that's all I need to say. And then after that, my to-do list was shower, shave, and come to church. That was my to-do list this Saturday morning. Wow, thank you. Oh, I'm going to tell Kaylee that I caught an applause, and that's my new expectation at home. But anyways, that was my to-do list today. But here's the thing. I have not thought about any of those things after I checked it off. I moved right on. Because a to-do list has a start and an end. On the flip side, an invitation, by definition, is a request to be present or participate in something. I love that definition. Maybe write that down somewhere. An invitation is to be present or participate in something. Jesus is not giving us a to-do list. Jesus is giving us an invitation. There is a really big difference. If Jesus was giving a to-do list, a lot of us would have checked a lot of the things we've already done, and we wouldn't think about it. On the flip side, Jesus is giving us an invitation. You see, Jesus is speaking to a bunch of people that we could say probably weren't living life to the full. And Jesus is saying, hey, I know your to-do list. I'm not asking you to follow me to check that box. I'm inviting you to follow me because here's what we get to be a part of. There's a really big difference between a to-do list and an invitation. And that's Jesus's invitation for us today. When we read these Beatitudes, Jesus is saying that we can live an abundant life. We can forget the to-do list. We can be a part of bringing God's kingdom to Lake Forest, to Mission Viejo, to RSM, to Ladera. Wherever you live, God is saying at your school, in your neighborhood, on your sports team, in your life group, on your street, in your family, you can actually be a part of what I'm doing right now. I don't know about you, but that is an enticing offer. It is not an easy offer, but it is an enticing offer. The Beatitudes are an invitation to bring heaven to earth. And the last thing the Beatitudes reveal God's kingdom. The Beatitudes reveal God's kingdom. You see, the Beatitudes are revealing to us the kind of world that God is ushering in. And what does it look like when God has his way in the world? Well, that's where we get to, blessed are those who blank, and then the next line is what the God's kingdom is revealing to us. You see, Jesus paints the picture that the poor are not written off, people are not just forgotten about, that everybody can have compassion and mercy. Whatever the next line is, the Beatitudes are revealing that right now, that's what God's kingdom can be for us and those around us. And you see, when God's kingdom arrives, those who are dissatisfied with the world will be satisfied. And that's what's enticing about this. That's what should move you into action to share this good news with everybody you know, is because that the Beatitudes reveal something different. That should actually make people go, there's something different about that person. Once again, this is super countercultural. Our world has its own list of Beatitudes, and God's kingdom has a very different list. Success and money and happiness aren't necessarily bad things, and that's what the world would use. However, but if they are the markers of what it means to have a good life, then it leaves most of the world out. There's a really small category that fit into what the world says. Successful, rich, successful, I already said that. But that's what the world says. And God is saying, hey, I'm going to flip the script because I've got something so much richer and so much greater. You see, God's kingdom, friends, really different. God's kingdom, really different. So the Beatitudes reveal that actually we don't have to wait to die to go to heaven to be a part of bringing heaven on earth. You right now can be a part of what God is doing right now in our community. So what does that look like tangibly? What does that look like as a high schooler who attends HSM, who's going to go out for the other 6 days of the week? I don't know, but I have a few thoughts that I would love for you to share, and then we're going to read the Beatitudes one more time with a little piece of homework. I think it means for you that you have an invitation right now to bring heaven to earth. Have you ever thought about that? Have you ever actually thought about that? If the Holy Spirit is residing in your heart, you have an invitation right now to bring heaven to earth. somewhat of an overwhelming thought. Also, somewhat an honoring thought. I think it also means that you have an invitation to channel your thoughts, your feelings, your circumstances towards Jesus. Whatever is going on in your life, I wish I could know everything about all of your lives. I don't, but I do know things. There's complicated aspects of every one of our lives, mine included. But the Beatitudes say that whatever you're feeling, whatever your circumstance is, whatever your family dynamic is, whatever you're struggling with, you can channel that to Jesus right now because he addresses it in the Beatitudes. And then lastly, which we're going to talk about for the weeks to come, you have an invitation to this blessed life. You have an invitation to live out these Beatitudes, these fruit of the Spirit right now in your life. And maybe this week, you might just choose one. Maybe this week you might choose one that you're going to say, hey, for the next 6 days until I get back to HSM for week two of Blessed, this is the characteristic, this is the description that I really want to work on. For me this week, as I was prepping and reading through this passage, I've read this passage a ton of times, but God just kept bringing me back to blessed are those who are merciful. Right now, my life is a little busy. I have a toddler, as I said, and it's really hard to give forgiveness, have compassion, not get frustrated because I'm tired. And essentially, it's really hard sometimes to give mercy to the people I love the closest to me. So as I was reading this passage this week, I just kept finding myself stumbling upon that verse. And here's what I want to do. I want to read this passage out loud one more time. And I would love for you to read it on your outline and ask God to reveal one statement that you are going to choose to practice and live out this week. Before I do that, though, I do want to pray real quick. It's not our closing prayer, but I do want to pray because there's something about praying and asking God to invite him into our passage before we respond. So let me just pray real quick, and then we'll read through it. Jesus, you know right now which beatitude every person is going to circle or star or highlight. So we are asking right now that you would reveal that to us. Amen. Let me read this passage. And my encouragement once again, which one is God saying, ding, 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 work on this week? Blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are those who mourn, for they will be comforted. Blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. Blessed are those who hunger and thirst for righteousness, for they will be filled. Blessed are the merciful, for they will be shown mercy. Blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. Blessed are the peacemakers, for they will be called children of God. Blessed are those who are persecuted because of righteousness, for theirs is the kingdom of heaven. Blessed are you when people insult you, persecute you, and falsely say all kinds of evil against you because of me. Rejoice and be glad, because great is your reward in heaven. For in the same way they persecuted the prophets who were before you. I don't know which one you circled. And if you didn't, man, friend, I would really encourage you to just mentally note one right now. Jesus has a way of speaking to us when we invite him into prayer and scripture. And that's your homework this week, to be blessed and work on that beatitude. Your last fill-in and your bottom line is this: God's kingdom is different and better. God's kingdom is different and better. Let's pray. Jesus, we thank you that you offer something different and better. Jesus, we thank you that you give us these lists of beatitudes, that we can spend time recognizing that we get to be a part of bringing heaven to earth. God, I pray for every student in this room, Lord. I pray that you would just bless and keep them, that you would speak to them uniquely tonight, that whatever they circle, Jesus, that you would give them ample strength, courage, and resolve to live out this beatitude. Because, Jesus, we know when we live out these beatitudes, something is different in us and something is noticeable about us to those who don't know you yet. God, I thank you for this room. I thank you for these high school students, God. I pray that you would just bless and keep them this next week. In Jesus' name we pray, amen.